Okay, wonderful. So, Deiric, let's talk a little bit about the importance of leadership charisma in this day and age.
Sure. Dario, let's put it in the context of the economic times we're in now. Think of 2008, when things started to go pear-shaped in economies worldwide. And we started to realize we had a problem, and it was going to impact our bottom line. So the most obvious thing when things start to turn down is you start shaving costs. You start fine-tuning your processes and re-engineering everything so that during 2008, 2009, and to some extent 2010, organizations that acted quickly enough were able to actually maintain a relatively stable bottom line in the face of an extraordinarily unstable economic situation. As we enter into 2011, organizations still have to report to their shareholders. They still have to return the same results. And there are no more costs to be cut. There are no more efficiencies to be achieved from processes. So what they're left with is they have to get more out of the people that work for them. They have to engage them more. Now, engagement has been around for, I don't know, a dozen years or thereabouts as a concept. The idea that if somebody is sufficiently engaged with their work, they will give you more of themselves. They'll give you what is called their discretionary input on their job. They'll give you their discretionary effort. Now, I love my job. I love the company I work for. I'm truly engaged with it. And you put me working with somebody who is a leader who just fails to inspire me, fails to make that engagement sufficiently intense that I want to give that extra 10% or 20%. And I'm not going to give you what you need in 2011. So as we enter into 2011, it's absolutely critical that the people we have in leadership positions are people who will positively engage their people. There have always been a class of leaders that we refer to as charismatics, charismatic leaders. And we all know what charisma means. We all know what charismatic leader is. It's somebody that inspires you. It's a JFK in a political sense. It's a Martin Luther King. In a business sense, it's people like Steve Jobs, for example. People who get extraordinary results from their people. Well, in 2011, every leader needs to get extraordinary results from their people. Every leader needs to become more charismatic because they need to engage them more. So that's why it has never been more important that leaders have the ability to charismatically impact those who work for them to get those extra results or those better results.
Now, you mentioned people such as Steve Jobs and JFK. It almost seems that they have a certain gift. Are you saying that we need more people like JFK and Steve Jobs who have that gift, or, you know, is this something that people can develop on their own? Because it's certainly, there seems to be a prevailing maybe wisdom or prevailing thinking that charisma is something that you're born with.
Yeah, you know, and you know what charisma means? Charisma is a Greek word that was coined a few thousand years before Christ walked the earth. And it means God-given gift. And the Greeks gave it to those of their leaders who had the ability to inspire people in the same way as the charismatic leaders we talk about today. And because they couldn't figure out what it was that they had, they decided it must be magical or it must be something that is God-given, that is born inside you, that you have it or you don't have it. What we've shown in a research throughout 2010 is that it's not actually inborn. It's all about behavior. If you interact with people in certain specific ways, you have a charismatic impact upon them. If you don't, you don't. Now, some people, like Steve Jobs, like the Martin Luther Kings, like the John F. Kennedys, have a natural instinct for those behaviors. The rest of us have to learn what those behaviors are and then learn to put them into action. But once we do, we become charismatic.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about those behaviors. I mean, give us some examples of the types of behaviors that make people more charismatic.
Well, let me frame them. Before we talk about specific behaviors, let me frame it and tell you two of the key principles that we uncovered when we looked at all of the behaviors that the research told us were responsible for driving a charismatic impact on other people. And if you think of any behavior that you use when you interact with the people that you lead or you manage in the context of these two principles, and you make sure that they positively align with these two principles, you absolutely, undoubtedly will increase your charismatic impact upon people. The first one of those is what we call the charismatic equation. It's very simple and it's very intuitive. Charismatic equation says that the extent to which you are perceived as being charismatic is the extent to which people either feel or fare better after every interaction with you. Now, think about it in the context of John F. Kennedy or Martin Luther King. Why were they charismatic? Because when people heard them speaking, or when they met them, or when they interacted with them, they went away either feeling better, feeling more positive, feeling more energized, or they went away more capable of doing what they wanted to do. You take Steve Jobs. He impacts people in terms of the way he energizes them, makes them feel an awful lot better after he's made his presentations to his folks. He energizes them, but he also enables them. He empowers them to be able to do an awful lot more. Now, if you make me feel or fare better every time I meet you, I'm going to want to interact with you an awful lot more. So you start to have an impact upon me, which is exactly the same as the charismatic leaders of history.
So give us an example of, say, you know, in day-to-day work life, of maybe somebody who doesn't have the gift of Steve Jobs who is able to do that with a coworker or a direct report.
Well, let me give you an example of some of the behaviors that really, you know, that anybody can put into action if they want to, that can make that vital difference. Hanging in the hall of every single organization in corporate America is a thing called a vision statement. And it's normally in very highfalutin language, and it says what the company was founded to be and what it will become. That's very meaningful in the context of a corporate strategic planning. But to every individual working in that organization, it doesn't necessarily have that same meaningfulness. And what the charismatic leader does is he puts that vision in the context of what's in it for the individuals working in an organization. So the charismatic leader recognizes that the people who are working for him in 2011 have been hammered over the last couple of years by a difficult economic situation where they've lost that sense of security, financial security, family security, job security that they might have had in previous years. And they recognize that if they're going to get those people to give 110%, that they have to give them a personalized version of the corporate vision that says, if we achieve our vision, here's what's in it for you. So that's one of the things right away as a leader that you can do. You make sure that you understand what is it that each of your people personally want to achieve, where they want to get, what their vision is for the future, and then you interpret the corporate vision in the context of that. Now, if I think that helping you achieve what you need to achieve, the corporate vision, is going to help me achieve what I want to achieve, hell, you're charismatic.
Tell me about the relationship between, you know, leadership charisma and really understanding what your employee is trying to get out of their job and their life, and how knowing that will make you a more charismatic leader.
All of the behaviors that are laid out in leadership charisma are life skills. They're behaviors that anybody who interacts with people and has to get the best possible results from them can apply them and get much better results. So take the example of a teacher. A teacher wants to appeal charismatically to the students that are sitting in front of him or her so that they will engage with them and want to learn the material and want to get superior results. So a teacher that applies the same results as a C-suite executive will, or the same behaviors as a C-suite executive, will get similarly improved results because they engage their people to a much greater extent.
What's really interesting is that I remember back in engineering school, I had a professor that, you know, on the surface, if you saw him out on the street, would not be at all charismatic from a, you know, just the look and the way he walked and whatnot. But when you got him in a classroom talking about some technical subject like fluid dynamics, all of a sudden he came to life, which tells me that, you know, leadership charisma is to some degree situational. Is that true?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. In fact, you describe your professor there, and he lights up. He gets up in front of people and he lights up. Why is that? It's because he really passionately feels enthusiastic about the subject that he's speaking on. Now, think of the way that you behave when you're around somebody who's energetic and enthusiastic. You get somebody who really is passionately engaged with their subject. The first thing it does is it makes you want to get some of their feel-good factor. Because you can see it. It's written all over their faces. Somebody who's enthusiastic, they look happy. They sound positive. They sound upbeat. And we all want that. So we unconsciously, all of the research shows, we unconsciously start to tune in with them. We start to copy their behavior. We start to copy their enthusiasm, and their moods are so highly contagious that we actually start to feel the way they feel when we act the way they act. If we do that, then we start to feel exactly as enthusiastic and positive as they do. Now, that makes that person charismatic. You take that individual who is talking on the subject of their lives in an environment where they're comfortable, and you put them talking about something that they really don't care about, and they will be as uncharismatic as they can possibly be. It's very, very situational. Another example of that situational nature of charisma is how you can have somebody who is up on their feet, and they're the best presenter you've ever seen in your life. Energetic, dynamic, they're turned on, they love being up there. And they come down off the stage and people crowd in around them, and because they don't have incredibly good one-to-one skills, they are completely charismatically bypassed. So you get somebody who has an enormous charismatic appeal up on the stage and has, dramatically lower down off the stage. And similarly, you get people who on a stage cannot string 10 words together. But one-on-one, because they're great listeners, because they're genuinely interested in other people, because they're genuinely engaged with other people, they affect a set of behaviors that make them charismatically appeal to people.
So it really challenges, I think, the traditional definition of charisma.
Absolutely. Charisma. Here's the problem with charisma. It is this wide and just about this deep, or about that deep. So it's so wide, and it covers, it's a woolly, woolly definition. So you got people talk about Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt as being charismatic. We talk about charismatic Christians. We talk about charisma in the context of it being a magical or a God-given gift. And it's too wide and it's too non-specific. But when you put it into the context of somebody who is trying to get superior results from other people, and you say the person who has this so-called leadership charisma is somebody who can inspire people to the extent that those people want to deliver the results they need them to deliver, then you start to get something that you can actually research. And that's what we did. We defined leadership charisma specifically as that quality that a leader has when people are so moved and inspired by them that they give more of themselves to help that leader achieve their objectives.
So it seems like a big part of improving your own leadership charisma is really having a sense of your own leadership behaviors.
Oh, it's being able to step outside yourself and look at yourself and examine yourself. Here's a line from the book. And I think if you read this book, and there's 312 pages, I can't remember how many words are in those 312 pages, but here are about 40 or 50 words that tell you everything you need to know about charisma and behavior. And that is that everything you do or do not do as a leader interacting with your people has an impact on either raising or lowering your charismatic impact upon them. And that's right from the way you walk into the room, the way you hold yourself, the way you dress, the way you address them, the extent to which you care about their concerns, the extent to which you're concerned about what they want to get from life. Absolutely everything impacts your charisma. There's an analogy that we use. And we talk about it being almost like a kaleidoscope. And I'm sure you've seen a kaleidoscope. You look through a tube, and you've got a number of mirrors that are at various different angles. And in there, you've got maybe 100 or 200 colored beads. And you get this wonderful pattern, this fractal-like pattern from the interaction of the mirrors. Now, when you look through the tube, you turn it, and if even one bead moves, the picture changes to something that wasn't there before and will never be there again once you move the tube. One tiny bead moves and the pattern changes out of sight. A leader who is so aware of their behaviors that they can change even one key behavior, even one of the 26 behaviors that we've identified as being critical in driving charisma, can change the impact they have on their people dramatically, just for one behavior. Now imagine if you are aware of yourself and you make yourself aware of your behaviors enough that you change two of those, or three of them, or four of them. And it's easy. It's not rocket science. These are everyday behaviors. And if you want to change them, you can. But it starts with knowing what you're doing right now.
And how do you get a sense of what you're doing right now?
You have to assess yourself. You have to have, the only way that you can determine the extent to which you're charismatic right now is to look through the eyes of the people whom you're trying to charismatically impact. So if you work for me, I want to know, what do you see me do day to day? What are the behaviors you observe me engaging in when I interact with you that make me charismatic or not? And the only way to do that is to assess. So what we do, it's very simple. We take a 70 behavior leadership model. And these are 70 behaviors that 20 years of research has determined are the key things that separate the best leaders from the rest. And we ask all of the people who work for an individual leader to rate that leader on a scale of 1 to 5 on the extent to which they demonstrate those behaviors day to day. Now, the 26 charismatic behaviors are included in there. So I get all of the people who work for you to rate you on the extent to which you demonstrate the behaviors. And I'll tell you, hey, Dario, here are 10 behaviors that are critical drivers of charisma, and you do them already naturally. Keep doing them. Here are some things that you're doing that are anti-charismatic. Stop doing them. And here are some things that are you're not doing. And if you start doing them, you can change them dramatically. I think it was Deming said, you cannot manage what you cannot measure. So you have to start, if you want to become a more charismatic leader, you have to start by measuring how charismatic you are right now. That's the critical start point. Then you can start behavior by behavior in increasing your charismatic impact.
So you had just mentioned about the importance of evaluating your own leadership charisma. Is that something that you can get out of the book?
Yes, it is. There are lots of tips in there to tell you exactly how to know if you're exhibiting and demonstrating those charismatic behaviors. But really, the best way to evaluate your charisma at any point in time is through a formal evaluation. And in the book, we talk about how you can get yourself evaluated to get what we call a leadership charisma index, which is a rating of the extent to which the people who work for you currently perceive you as being charismatic. And there's your start point for driving forward, increasing your charisma, increasing the level of engagement, and therefore the bottom line results that you achieve from those people.
So tell me about the content of the book.
Yeah, the book is based on four key steps to becoming more charismatic. The first one is easy. It's a decision. If charisma is based upon behavior, well then the only thing that stops anybody from being more charismatic is the decision to put into play those behaviors that will make them more charismatic. So the first step in the book, it says, hey, you want to be charismatic, make the decision and make the commitment to enable those behaviors in yourself. And once you've made that decision, go to step two. Step two, we talk about the importance of self-confidence. And this is so critically important. It's like we build the book like a pyramid. The four steps are built on a foundation of self-confidence, because you've never ever seen somebody who will charismatically impact you who did not exude self-confidence. The great thing about self-confidence is it's very easy to develop. You develop it by developing a really strong set of personal goals and a plan for achieving those goals. Because once you have really clear goals for yourself and have a plan for achieving those, the positivity, the optimism that engenders in you just makes you glow with that sort of positivity that other people who don't have that will find charismatic. So the second step is building your own self-confidence. Third step in the book, we look at physical charisma, and we look at all of the body language that determines the extent to which you are charismatic or not. And it includes things like smiling. You look at charismatic people, take Bill Clinton, for example, highly charismatic individual, smiling all the time. Every time he meets you, he smiles. And it's not one of these social smiles that's barely cracking his face. It's genuine mirth that cracks the eyes, what the researchers call a Duchenne smile. When you smile at somebody like that, you immediately, physiologically impact the brain. You smile at somebody with a genuine smile, and they get a drench of serotonin and dopamine into the brain. These are the feel-good chemicals that make that people get from exercise, that they get from chocolate, that make them go back to it again and again. And you smile at somebody and you set off a chain reaction, very interesting chain reaction. The person you smile at gets a little dose of serotonin and dopamine. Because they get that feel good, they smile. When they smile back at you, you get a little dose of serotonin and dopamine, so you smile a little bit more. And so a leader walking into a room of the people who works for them and genuinely smiling at them, even once, can set off a chain reaction that has an extraordinary impact. This is, again, one of those little behavioral beads that I mentioned when we spoke about the kaleidoscope, that this is a small thing that you can do, and you can decide to do, and you can anybody can do, that can have a huge impact upon your charisma. Another thing is things like touching. Touch is so highly charismatic. Again, when somebody even touches your forearm, it has a physiological impact upon you. Again, it generates a release of serotonin and dopamine to the brain. It also releases the chemical oxytocin, which is the chemical that made you bond with your mother. Just because we've grown up and we've grown beyond the mommy stage doesn't mean that every time somebody touches us, we don't get a dose of oxytocin. When you touch somebody, they get a dose of what the researchers call that bonding chemical that makes them feel closer to them. So there's a huge amount of physical behaviors that drive a charismatic impact on others. And the last step, Dario, is really about the day-to-day behaviors and the way a leader interacts with people. For example, in the current economic climate, none of us need anybody else to feel negative. We can achieve that just by reading a newspaper or by turning on the news on the TV or radio. We don't need to get that from our leader. If we go into the office and we meet our leader and they are downbeat, or they're talking down the economy, talking down their opportunities, talking down the organization, or in any way negative, that's going to be communicated to us. We start to feel bad and we start to spiral downwards with it. When you're a leader, and if you want to be a charismatic leader, you have to be positive. You have to, and that doesn't mean being unrealistic. It means choosing to accept the view that there is always something in every negative situation that you can do positively that will change things, even a fraction. It's highly, highly charismatic. A leader who continually, in the face of adversity, finds that small thing that you can do to take control is highly charismatic. Another thing is expecting the best of people. Two things the research shows define the extent to which a person achieves the best possible results for the people that work for them. The expectations of the leader and their expectations of themselves. If you're my leader and you show me that you genuinely believe that I'm capable of extraordinary performance, you do what Dale Carnegie said, you set a high reputation for me to live up to. If you say to me, I think you're an extraordinary person, you're capable of extraordinary things, I think you can achieve great things for this organization, I do not want to lose that reputation, and I'll work hard to achieve that. I'll persist longer in doing what it takes to achieve what you want me to achieve. Once that happens, it triggers the second thing that determines my performance, and that is my expectation of myself. So you expect something positive of me. I work that little bit harder. I achieve better results than I ever thought possible. I start to think, hell, I could get more. I could achieve even more than this. And because I believe I can, then I push a little bit harder and I try a little bit longer and I persist and I get better results. Charismatic leader understands that. So the last section of the book is a step-by-step program that tells you, here's how to interact with your people in a way that they will perceive you as being charismatic. If they perceive you as being charismatic, they will engage with their jobs. If they engage with their jobs, they'll get superior results.
So, Deiric, obviously leadership charisma is a fascinating topic. Where can somebody go to learn more about leadership charisma and the book?
Two places, Dario. First, you can go to the website, which is www.leadership-charisma.com, or you can buy the book directly on Amazon.